Today, I'm going to do a comparison of the mycological activity between a healthy forest and an unhealthy forest. What you see here, it's a forest technically. This is a planted forest. This land was cut down and replanted by the size of these trees, I'd say about 40 years ago. And as is often the case with a conifer plantation, the ground is all covered with sphagnum moss. Notice there's almost nothing growing under here. It's just sphagnum moss and conifers. That's because conifers slowly acidify the soil, making it hostile to herbaceous growth, the kind of plants that most animals and other wildlife need for food. But sphagnum moss likes acidified soil, and it colonizes such areas, and then it spreads its own toxins, which further drive out herbaceous growth. Now during the summer, this is November 6th, during the summer there is some herbaceous growth up in here, but it's not abundant. We have some bracken right over there. I don't think bracken technically qualifies as herbaceous growth, and I've been hiking through here during the summer. I see some various plants in the Asteraceae genus. I see a few odd berries and rose hips, but there just honestly isn't much in here. But it's the mycological differences, the differences in the fungi, that I think are especially important. A forest like this does not really have a healthy fungal population, which is very important because it's the fungi under the soil of a healthy forest, in particular a wild forest, an unmanaged forest, that network the trees together and allow the trees to develop a kind of sentience, a kind of awareness that allows the trees to respond effectively to their environment. They can actually, trees that are networked via the mycelial threads underground, sometimes referred to as the wood wide web, they form a group intelligence, and they're able to moderate the environment of a forest. They can control the humidity beneath the canopy of the trees. They can raise and lower the temperature, both at ground level, in the water that flows under the trees, and in the atmosphere above. They can control how quickly, to some degree, they release humidity and oxygen. They have a number of ways of regulating their environments. They also coordinate how they're going to share sugars with each other, share resources. And they coordinate the sharing of antimicrobial products generated by the mycelial threads underground. And in such forests, you find a large abundance of mushrooms, many species, many of which are healthy. Whereas in a forest like this, if you look around, I'm going to go over some of the mushrooms that we're going to see in here. But if you look around, you just don't see that much. We have this here. This is an aged guild mushroom. I believe it's a cordinarius. I wouldn't eat it because the deadliest and the most poisonous mushrooms are among the guild variety, and especially among the guild variety that are mycorrhizal or symbiotic with trees. We have another one right there. Here we have another one. And if we look around, we see various flepiotas and some cordinarius. These are mushrooms, most of which are useless, some of which are benign, but not very good to eat. And there's a few quite deadly ones in these species. There just isn't much in a forest like this to benefit anything, honestly, except the loggers who will eventually come and cut this forest down for pulpwood. If you look up in the trees, there isn't really any red squirrel activity. There's not much in the way of grouse. They also need herbaceous growth. They feed a lot among the herbaceous growth on the ground. And this, to the wildlife, is essentially just a desert. You just see on and on you go. There's just barren conifer woods. Right over here, we do have one useful fungus. Called witch's butter. This witch's butter is a bit old, it's getting a bit dark. Butcher's butter is a gelatin fungus. It has no specific shape, it's amorphous. All the gelatin fungi are edible or medicinal to some degree or another. Worst case scenario, they're harmless. But witch's butter is not growing here because the forest is in a good state. Witch's butter prefers to grow, well, it prefers to grow on dead logs. It prefers to grow on death. It's one of the few beneficial things we can get out of a forest. And in nature, witch's butter would occur in areas where trees have been blown down and are decaying, or where there's been a forest fire that would grow on the stumps. But witch's butter is awfully common in Nova Scotia. This is a fungal indicator of an unhealthy wood. It just so happens that this particular fungus is edible and beneficial. In fact, you should try it sometime. If you see this shapeless orange-looking stuff on stumps or old logs, it doesn't have any real flavor like the agaricus by Spoor, the common store-bought mushroom, or some of the wild mushrooms I enjoy, such as Pinellas serotinus, or which is called the late oyster, or the Pleurotus osteriastus, another oyster that I'm looking for at this time of the year, or some of the earlier season mushrooms like the gypsy mushrooms, aka horse mushrooms. Its proper name is the Agaricus arvinensis. It doesn't have really much flavor. It tastes like tofu, to be honest, which is, in my opinion, to say it tastes like nothing. But it's a good stock mushroom to add to stews and such to thicken them up, and it's nutritious. But mostly what we see in a wood that's been planned by foresters to become forest pulp plantation, well, we see a lot of nothing. And among the fungi, when we do see fungi, apart from relatively uncommon things like this witch's butter, what we see are fungi that are gilled, they're mycorrhizal to the conifers, and they're poisonous. I've been developing a theory over the last couple of years as I've observed the development between fungi in conifer forests versus wild forests that we find here in Nova Scotia. Wild forests, which are full of a variety of mushrooms, many of which are so medicinal and beneficial. Well, it's well known that trees have defense mechanisms. When they're being preyed on by insects, they may release pheromones that will draw in predators for that insect. If they're being attacked by something else, they may change the way they taste, like in, I think it's the acacia in Africa. If it's being eaten by giraffes, it'll release a chemical into its leaves that makes itself very bitter. Oak trees are known to make themselves very, very bitter with tannin, to the point that the tannin can actually become toxic if they're being preyed upon by deer or other herbivores. The forest can defend itself. And I have a theory that when a forest is unhealthy, it doesn't know what kind of fungi to produce. So it's on guard and it's defensive the way an injured person, say somebody with a dislocated arm, would be defensive. If you ever tried to treat an injured person, I've done some field medicine in my lifetime, most of which has been in wilderness areas. And if you come across a person and you try to help them, you have to be very cautious because they're inclined to attack. Somebody's dislocated an arm and you're trying to help them reset it, they're likely to take a swing at you. Or broken a limb or need stitches or whatnot. That's why nurses and doctors get assaulted so much, because people are instinctively defensive when they've been injured. And I think forests likewise are defensive when they've been injured. And so we see unhealthy fungal development within that forest. In no figurative sense, forests develop sentience through their networking underground by the mycelial threads. Those are fungal threads that have symbiotic relationships with the trees. And a healthy forest, I think, relates to the environment in a healthy way, which we're going to see. I'm going to push deeper into the woods now. We're going to get past this conifer plantation and coming into an Acadian forest. It's one of the rare ones. This one's been hidden by dint of steep mountains, which so far have kept it safe, though the retired biologist Bob Bancroft, who's very active in environmental causes, has recently informed me that the forestry industry has developed new technology to harvest woods along steep hillsides, which is about the only place they can get big trees anymore, and they really want them. Make no mistake, the Nova Scotia forestry industry and the Canadian forestry industry isn't really an industry, it's a cartel. And they will bully and lie and dissemble to get the last of that wood. And they will take it if they can. And right now, the government under Stephen McNeil is allowing them to do whatever they want. In fact, McNeil has shown, he's shown himself to be incredibly incompetent, undereducated, worse than ignorant, simply stupid. Ignorance is nobody's fault. They just haven't had a chance to learn something. Stupid is when you could know better and you should know better, but you choose not to know better. And he's shown himself to be stupid in regard to both the environment and the people he's supposed to represent. And he's pretty much allowing our forestry cartels to do whatever they want. It's up to us to protect these forests, and that's going to start by spreading information and helping people understand, which is why I'm producing these videos about what life really is in the forest and what a healthy versus an unhealthy forest looks like. I'm going to shut up now so you can listen. Just listen. This camera has a very good microphone. If there was an animal within hundreds of yards of here for you to hear, you'd hear it. There's nothing. This is a dead forest. It is a green desert. It is conifers. I think these are red spruces. Sphagnum moss. And a few unhealthy, unsavory gilled mushrooms growing on the sphagnum moss. With the occasional good thing, this witch's butter here. Nature always finds a way to slip something good in. But this is an unhealthy forest. Let's go to a healthy one. Here's the boundary between the conifer forest and the old forest. Now, the trees aren't big yet, this area, about an acre or so of it. I think it was cleared over quite a few years for firewood. I can tell it was a partial cutting because there's trees at all different ages in there. But about 100 yards, 200 yards further on, this is going to metamorphose into that rare and wonderful thing that we just don't see much of in Nova Scotia anymore, thanks to our forestry cartel, a mature Acadian forest. We have fresh work of a porcupine here. And there's another one over there on the right, just out of sight. So I decided to film right here. I'm just pushing through that boundary area where foresters were cutting. Now this isn't super recent. This is by the size of these trees 10 or 15 years back. But look at this. Well, there's the trees to give you a sense of the age. These trees are, well, probably no thicker than my forearm, and most of them less than 20 feet tall. So 20 years back, and here we have this enormous tire. This is a tire from a large industrial forestry machine. I couldn't tell you what kind because they go on different ones. This tire is about 6 feet in diameter and weighs several hundred pounds. I'm just pulling this up because, you know, I've researched the operations of our forestry cartel over quite a few years, and I've visited dozens of clear cuts on foot and seen many, many more from the air, usually by way of drones and occasionally by satellite imagery. And it's been my experience, Big Forestry rarely ever bothers to clean up its mess. We all know that Canadian industry doesn't clean up their mess. Our government has mining companies move in, they go bankrupt and move out and leave their mess, and cleaning that up is footed by the taxpayer. And we get the same thing with Big Forestry. And I see stuff like this all the time. In fact, just back over that way, there's old fuel canisters and beer bottles and stuff from lunches and meals that were made back here while they were working. But this here, I mean, this enormous tire, to leave something like this back here, this wasn't any haphazard guy just forgetting his beer bottle in the woods. Wes, come here, buddy. Go over there. Go over there. Go. Come here, pal. Wes, come over here. Sit. Sit. Good dog. So I just put my dog in front of it for scale. I'll come over to the side because he's in front of it. It's giving a false sense of scale. So there's Will-O-Wisp. He's about 2 feet on the left of it. And Will-O-Wisp is a fair-sized dog. He's 60 or 70 pounds. And this tire here is almost 6 feet across. This was a huge, huge tire on an enormous machine, a feller harvester, a skidder, I don't know. But I do know this, that this isn't uncommon at all. It is very common to find garbage of the forestry industry left behind in the woodlands. If it's hidden, they don't worry about it. You can see right up over there the boundary of the Acadian forest. It's about maybe 200 yards away. You can see the woods on the right and then all the cut on the left. If I were to fly a drone over this, this clear cut would extend on for thousands of acres. Now the scary thing is, from the air, well, these young trees, they're going to be almost indistinguishable from older trees. And that's part of the tragedy of the decimation that's going on in our forest, is clear cuts, when they're relatively fresh, they can easily be distinguished. But a few years in, like this one here, 10, 20 years in, from the air, you know, you get up 500, 1,000 feet, and you can barely tell one forest from the other. Now, there's a huge difference on the ground and in the soil. The soil hasn't developed a new mycological equilibrium. The animals are disrupted. There's no place for the species that require old growth forest. A new forest like this doesn't do a whole heck of a lot to purify water. It cannot manage its environment. It cannot absorb carbon all that efficiently. Cut down forests in a process of early regrowth like this, again, even herbaceous growth, it might support deer and some wildlife, but the benefits you would see from an old forest, carbon storage and water purification, they just aren't happening. And a new forest like this has not developed the mind that an old forest has through the linking of the mycelial threads that create the wood wide web and allow the forest to develop an awareness and manage its environments and support itself and the creatures that dwell inside of it. It's just not there. So this is hardwoods grown beyond the conifers there, young cut over hardwoods. This land appears to be allowed to regrow in its wild state. And it will have some wildlife in it because there's forage for the herbivores, but it's nowhere near approaching the fecundity and the conservation value that an old forest that we're about to enter offers. It's just nowhere near. Now, I said this was cut recently, 20 years ago, and a lot of people might be thinking, 20 years, Cliff, that's not all that recent. It would take 100 years for a hardwood forest to reach a state that a realistic ecologist would consider to be mature. So 20 years, well, 20 years is effectively like about 14 years old for a human being. It's an immature forest. Now, to develop a truly mature, diverse, balanced ecology, to develop all the give and take, the mycelial networking, the variety of species in the soil and the water, the management of the atmosphere within and above the forest, for all those things to fully develop, that takes about 500 years. So in the true ecological span of time, and compared to the lifespans of trees, centuries, within a mature forest, trees don't live that long away from a forest. They're very dependent on one another. Within a forest, they can last for centuries because of the way they defend each other and share resources. But in the true ecological span of time, 20 years is only the blink of an eye. This forest is embryonic by the standards of an old forest. Here's the entry to the old forest. You can see how distinct it is. Bushy trees, so dense they're almost impossible to move through. And then the great trees beyond. I'm gonna have to put away the camera because I have to pass through this dense and bushy stuff, and I really can't afford to destroy this camera. But I'll put it back on in a moment. And you can see a rare old forest. This is very interesting to me. I've just passed through the boundary into the old forest, and no sooner did I than I'm coming across this. The camera probably doesn't show it all that well. It doesn't show contrast like the human eye can perceive, especially since we can see in three dimensions, and a camera can only relate three dimensions in a two-dimensional field. But this grass is disturbed by large, relatively flat prints. This is an American black bear. So I've just left the dead zone. I mean, it's literally 200 yards behind me, and I've passed the last 200 yards through the recent cutout that was allowed to grow wild. I'm just now entering the herbaceous forest, and already I'm coming across life right here with this with these tracks of this black bear. Maybe you can see the disturbance right there. We have deer scrapes right here. Deer tracks right there. There's its cloven hoof, two hooves. Punch through the leaf fall right there. So we're now into the old forest. And right away, we're finding abundant wildlife. Right away. And look at how green it is in here. Now, It is November 6th, so most of the herbaceous foliage is gone. But even despite that, there's a lot of green down here still surviving. Bracken, and up ahead you can probably hear the little brook and the small waterfalls over that way. That helps regulate the temperature even more. And there's more greenery down there. Better. We're going to find mushrooms, and I actually am out here looking for mushrooms today. Note that here in the herbaceous forest, there's no sphagnum moss on the ground. And that's because these wild hardwood trees, they promote a sweet soil which is very friendly to herbaceous growth of many different species. And usually when I say this, people are thinking of the plants they can see. But under the soil, there's a whole world that is unseen that is so extremely important. There are bacteria and mycelia. In a single teaspoon, there are miles of mycelial threads in a wild forest like this. Threads which network all the woodland and keep it healthy, which break down and composts all of this leaf fall into good, healthy, sweet soil that will actually grow things. There are literally hundreds of species of plants that will grow within the 20 or 30 yards around me, maybe thousands. And when we get down to the microscopic scale, millions. In a single grain of soil, one single grain of the soil will have millions of microscopic flora and mica, microscopic fungi. One single grain of the soil will have millions of microscopic flora, bacteria, and fungi on it. Everything here is alive. Everything is engaged in a beautiful dance that maintains a harmony that is a woodland. The size of these trees store thousands upon thousands of tons of atmospheric carbon in their cellulose, and they relay it underground. They transfer it among one another. That makes the atmosphere healthy. There's water just up ahead, clear as crystal. You could drink right out of it. There's springs that flow out of the ground over here. This forest has created an environment for itself that's protected from wind. It takes carbon, it gives us oxygen, it gives us pure water. This is a real forest and what it can do. It's a bank of life. It creates its own world, and it shares that world in a very beneficent fashion with everything that enters the forest. The forest is a kindly thing, this thing we cut down. The forest is an aware thing, this thing that we humans so mindlessly destroy for such petty reasons. This tree here, fairy benches, these are called. This old birch comes down and has a natural bench. It's where the dryads sit. Anyway, I haven't eaten since sunup, and here's a little boulder for a table, so Dog and I are going to take a break and then push further in. Our late lunch is just a simple affair. I figure I only have about 3 hours of light left, and I want to make the best of it, so just a little bread and brie and water. Excuse me, Dog. Good boy. Move. Now right here, we have a deer scrape. See all the foliage? And then we have this little patch of bare earth with some striations through it. That's a male deer, and he's come through here and he scraped this ground and left scent to attract does, which is why I've been hunting over here. I hate to, it's sort of unfair because there's all the cutwoods around here and the conifer plantations, and this is where the deer have to come to feed, but it's a remote area. There aren't really that many other hunters around, and it's a pretty sure area. But again, more sign that this area is alive with life, and sign of the value of this area. This area provides cover and food to the animals. That's why they're here. It doesn't take brilliant deduction to realize this is a place one would find deer. All you need to do is find an herbaceous woodland. If you find an herbaceous woodland surrounded by some relatively young woods, surrounded by conifer clear cuts, well, that's your central zone where the deer are feeding. So speaking of the comparative life in a healthy forest versus a conifer plantation, right here, we have an old snag. A snag in naturalist terms, is a dead tree that's still standing. This tree is a host to a whole forest of lichens, various species. Most of these lichens have healing properties. They can be used as medicine. Almost all lichens can. There's only a couple toxic species of lichens. Recently, there was a hallucinogenic species discovered. Lichens are a composite of a cyanobacteria or an algae cell with two different species of fungal cells. Because the fungal cells are constantly providing antimicrobials to the algal or bacterial cells, pretty much all lichens are medicinal. You have algae right down there, typical algae, it's edible in a pinch. Underneath, we have some newly emerging and older lepiota mushrooms. Probably toxic, many lepiotas are. Now, what drew me to this tree, actually I visited this tree a couple of days ago, so I've harvested it, but there's some new ones coming up. We have this mushroom under the bark right here. This is Pinellus serotinus. Sometimes these mushrooms get to be 6 inches in diameter. If you look up this tree, you can see where I've harvested them up a good ways. Anywhere I could reach with a stick. There's some about, 15 feet up, and I could get them off if I wanted, but I always make it a point to leave some to spread spore. It's never good to take everything. These Pinellus serotinus mushrooms have another name. They're late oysters. They're commonly mistaken for the true oyster, the Pleurotus mushroom. These aren't the true oyster, but they're very similar. They have many similar characteristics. They have dense gills, which fork at the end. They have a little stub of a stipe. They're roughly kidney or bean shaped. They have a greasy feel when they're fresh, just like a true oyster mushroom. True oysters tend to be paler, and they have a dense white flesh. Later on, I'll cut one of these in half, and you can see it has a... Whereas the Pinellus mushrooms have kind of a gray flesh, it's a little translucent in places. But they're a pretty close cousin of the oyster. Their taste is very similar. They have a very, very slight hint of bitterness. It's not unpleasant. I find it lends them character. And Daphne and I like to use these on pizzas and pastas, anything where you're going to have some cheese or something acidic like tomato sauce. They're very good for that. We fry them, we bake them, and she's experimenting with drying some today. And this was actually one of my driving forces for getting back here, because there are more trees back here where they're growing, especially along that brook, which I'm sure you can hear over there. They like humidity, and wherever you find humidity in fallen logs, you're likely to find Pinellus mushrooms growing, late oysters. But, like I was saying earlier, when you have a healthy woodland, you get a variety of mushrooms, and most of those mushrooms are beneficial. Most of the lichens in here are beneficial. Those brackens are edible. You shouldn't eat them. I noted in a previous video that brackens are mildly carcinogenic, but in a pinch, they're edible as well. I could dig in the soil under these maples and pull out truffle mushrooms. Even in the dead of winter, there's chaga growing on some of these trees. There's reishi, a beautiful red fan-shaped fungi growing on some of the fallen logs. The list goes on and on. In fact, one of the other things I'm going to get back here today are turkey tail mushrooms, which are very, very medicinal, and I add them to the chaga teas that I've been drinking for years. And I haven't been sick for years, not in years and years. Since I started drinking chaga, I just have not been sick at all. It's very potent, very good stuff. And I've been exposed frequently to people who are quite sick. My daughter, who is, well, like a typical kid, you know, she doesn't like to eat things that are healthy. And so she resists having the chaga, and she caught a nasty cold. I hear a coyote off in the distance over there. Camera probably didn't pick it up since I was facing the mic the other way. But she picked up this nasty cold about a month ago. It hit her pretty hard, knocked her out for about 10 days. And my wife got it, but she drinks chaga, not quite as regularly as me. She got it, and it took her 2 or 3 days to get over it, and it was very minor. I didn't get it. I had a little bit of a cough. Never had any symptoms, just a little bit of a cough, and it lasted less than a day. That's chaga. And anyway, it's very medicinal. These Pinellus mushrooms, by the way, have their own healing qualities. Here's some other good examples of these Pinellus mushrooms. You can tell them, among other things, because they like to grow in layers, like all oyster mushrooms. They like to grow over one another. This tree looks rather bereft of them because I did harvest it pretty thoroughly a couple of days ago. We have bracket mushrooms down here. And these are medicinal, these bracket mushrooms. I mean, this is nature in its natural state. It gives and gives. And if you understand it, and you know how to live with it, it gives you all you need. But no human has ever found a way to interfere with nature in a way that's actually beneficial. If this forest is cut and replanted with a conifer plantation, let's say it's cut and it's all replanted with maples, it's not a wild forest anymore. The old balance is gone. You get maples, and you get sap out of that. The forest won't be healthy like it would by being diversified, like it would by having natural growth of flora and fungi in the soil. It won't have the proper mycelial networking between the trees to create the awareness of the forest that helps it look after itself and everything that's in it. You can see the steep hillsides. You can see the steep hillsides all around me. This is why this forest still stands. I hope it never falls. I've gone about 50 yards from where I was filming the tree with the pleurotus and bracket mushrooms on it. Right here, we have another cousin of the pleurotus. All the pleurotus and its cousins, like the pinellas mushroom, they like to come up when the air is cool. There's another spot I like to go for sweetless mushrooms, which are a cousin of the boleet, and they also like it when the air is cool. It's an edible mushroom that grows on the ground and likes to link up its mycelia with the root systems of trees. But this here, particular cousin of the oyster, its common name is the angel wing. It's an edible mushroom. Now, you wouldn't want to eat this one if you had any reason to believe you had liver or kidney problems, because it has a mild toxin in it, and that toxin can make you pretty sick if your body cannot process it. But if you have a healthy liver and kidney, which I do, everybody in my family does, you wouldn't even notice that it's there. But this is an abundant mushroom. Feels greasy on top, it's moist, dense gills underneath, white flesh. The other main difference between this and the common pleurotus oyster mushrooms that I'm often after is this one's thinner. It's maybe a quarter of an inch thick, but it is white and fleshy and dense, and otherwise pretty tasty. The Japanese in particular like it. Now, right there, we have, looking like a cup, a pigskin mushroom. It's not edible, but what to me is interesting is look at that cup. It's filled with spore, billions of spore. That pigskin's almost 2 inches wide, and there's about an inch deep of spore in there. I'm going to dump it out and just do the mushroom a favor and help it spread its spore. It's not directly useful to me as a human, but it'll be my good deed for the day. I know that mushroom is doing something for this forest, so I'm going to help it spread its spore. But just beyond it, look right there. More witch's butter, which I'm going to harvest in a moment. It grows anywhere it can find decaying wood. And just to my left, right over there, is chaga growing on that dead birch. I'm going to go and harvest that. You could always use a little bit more chaga. It's fairly rare. I have a good bit of it at the house, but that doesn't look like a big piece, maybe a pound, and it'll come in handy. There you go. Now, I previously skimmed off a little bit of the black. That black is good to use, by the way. But I previously skimmed off a little bit of the black of that piece of chaga, just so you could see it, and I understand its colors a little better. It's black on the outside, bright orange on the inside when it's healthy, but this is a healthy woodland. A healthy woodland gives and gives. In the last book I wrote, The Wildwood Way, described trees as the only creatures on earth that only give. A forest only gives, and a healthy forest will take care of you. A knowledgeable person has everything here. Food, medicine, water. That forest cleaned water there is pure as crystal. A healthy forest will look after you. All you have to do is know how to live with it. Look at the thickness of that trunk that's so rare to see in Nova Scotia in the woods anymore. Now that trunk is at least 2 feet wide. I know I could not wrap my arms around it. It's a very old birch. We have another mushroom emerging right here. This one's about 6 inches long. You can tell by the scale of my knife. And this is an edible cousin of the jelly ear. Just another jelly fungus. All the jelly fungus are harmless. Most of them fairly pleasant to eat, tofu-like. But like I was saying, forests also produce toxic mushrooms. And right down there, we have mushrooms. Those look to me to be Lepiotis, which is a genus, not a species. I don't know the specific species, but many Lepiotis are quite deadly, possessing amatoxins, just like the Amanitis, the destroying angel, and the death cap. This is what Nova Scotia wood should be and could be if left to their own devices.